So now we're on to Thunderfoot's last video on the Hyperloop, where he attempts to answer people who have criticized him, and as we've seen, there's been a lot to criticize.
Now, many of you may remember when NASA claimed they'd found evidence of a new form of life, and basically the whole thing was bullshit from the very first get-go. And I was one of the first people to call bullshit on that, despite the fact that this was NASA, one of the largest, foremost scientific bodies on the planet, and I was just some guy on YouTube.
Yeah, this part isn't about the Hyperloop, but it does help show how full of himself Thunderfoot is. The problem is, it wasn't from NASA. It was from Felisa Wolf-Simon, who is a NASA research fellow, but the research he was doing was actually for the U.S. Geological Survey. NASA's involvement seems to be limited to publishing a release of the conference where Wolf-Simon was to announce the discovery. Lots of scientists, including several at NASA, criticized her findings very quickly. Thunderfoot was doing nothing more than riding a wave of mass criticism of the finding from pretty much everybody. In fact, his video came out after public criticisms from people like Carl Zimmer, Stephen A. Benner, Rosemary Redfield, and Alex Bradley, some of whom beat Thunderfoot to it by almost a week. And yet, Thunderfoot would have you believe that he's so much more knowledgeable and insightful than those schmoes over at NASA. Apparently, he has to do this to give himself undeserved credibility and spends almost 3 minutes doing it. And after seeing the complete fail that was the first two videos in this series, it's not hard to see why. It's also not hard to see why he has to attack Elon Musk himself.
Let me step back a little. Elon Musk did not make it big through technological inventions. He made it big through software and PayPal.
Thunderfoot, when last I checked, software was a form of technology. And although we're quite used to PayPal now, at the time it was introduced, it was quite an innovation.
Elon Musk did not actually invent the Hyperloop.
As far as I'm aware, Musk has never claimed to have invented the Hyperloop. He had the initial vision for it, but it was a team of a dozen engineers from SpaceX and Tesla Motors who worked for 9 months developing the concept. You know, with Thunderfoot claiming to be smarter than NASA, you'd think he'd learn from what happened the last time NASA refused to listen to the unanimous findings of a dozen engineers when they warned that cold weather could cause O-ring failure in the space shuttle's solid rocket boosters.
The vacuum train concept has been around for at least 100 years.
I really don't know what Thunderfoot's point here is supposed to be. The thing that's embarrassing for him here is, Goddard's proposal wasn't a vacuum either. It was reduced pressure, like the Hyperloop. Although apart from the low-pressure tube, it actually has fairly little in common with the Hyperloop. Also, Goddard's proposal, as well as others from the RAND Corporation and ET3, are acknowledged in the white paper. What points Thunderfoot thinks he has scored here is a mystery resolved only in his mind. Musk has degrees in physics and economics, which makes him more qualified in these areas than Thunderfoot, despite him having a doctorate in chemistry. And that's not counting those dozen engineers I mentioned. There's really not a lot of chemistry to evaluate here. Thunderfoot is engaging in ad hominem and poisoning the well attacks to criticize something he doesn't even understand the basics of. Many of his misconceptions can be sorted by simply reading the white paper.
Yet in the intervening 100 years, rockets have gone from this to this.
Thunderfoot just keeps digging himself in deeper and deeper. Here, he's showing a Saturn V rocket of the kind that took the astronauts to the moon, or at least lunar orbit, between 1968 and 1972. These are actually closer to the time of Goddard's 1926 flight than to today. Here's something Thunderfoot just doesn't seem to get. Every major invention was conceived long before it became practical. Incandescent light was invented by Humphrey Davy in 1802, 77 years prior to Edison's bulb. The first steam engine patent was issued 100 years before the first economically viable model was built. Charles Babbage designed his mechanical computer in 1822, but it wasn't actually built until 1855 and wasn't even used for large-scale practical purposes until the 1870s. Arthur C. Clarke invented the communication satellite in 1945, but the first one wasn't launched until 1960. Konstantin Tsiolkovsky described manned rockets and space stations in 1903. Leonardo da Vinci invented the helicopter in 1493, 446 years before the first one would lift off. Good ideas always have an incubation period before advances in technology, materials, and infrastructure catch up to the point where that idea can become an economic success. It takes almost 4.5 minutes for Thunderfoot to do anything resembling discussing the actual Hyperloop.
By far the most common objection to my video trashing the Hyperloop was that it runs under a partial pressure, not a vacuum. I just watched the first 2 minutes and realised that Thunderfoot actually knows jack shit. And yes, that's a huge difference. I've just read a little of the white paper and it doesn't say anything about a perfect vacuum, just a low pressure. But we're only talking about lower pressure. Stop saying vacuum, low pressure, low pressure, low pressure. And these comments just go on and on and on, chastising me for having not read the Hyperloop Alpha document. Well, let's take a look at the actual Hyperloop Alpha document, shall we? Well, there's the input is 100 pascals. That's 1,000th of an atmosphere. Curiously, exactly what I said in the video.
We've covered several times where Thunderfoot made a big deal about the vacuum. Only later in his second video did he get to the actual pressure. It's as if he finally realized how it actually worked, but he never went back on his earlier claims. In fact, he repeated some of them at the end of the video. And you can see plenty of other times where this assumption reared its ugly head. Like in this screenshot, which Thunderfoot used to claim that the forward turbine would have to spin 10 times faster than the turbine blades on a plane, when in reality the compression ratio needed by the Hyperloop is just 20 to 1, whereas the air compressors on some jets go over 50 to 1. He highlighted this portion for support, while not highlighting that this is required to get the pressures down to 1 micropascal, far lower than the 100 pascals of pressure that the Hyperloop operates at. He specifically highlighted a sentence fragment and left out a whole dependent clause. I mean, that's as bad as when creationists quote mind Darwin about the eye. And as a result, Thunderfoot is off by 8 orders of magnitude. That's a factor of 100 million. Thunderfoot seems to excel at making these enormous mathematical errors, and in the case of the Hyperloop, his assumption of a near-perfect vacuum seems to be the cause of much of it. But it becomes easy to understand why he keeps making this hideous blunder once you see this next part.
It's 999 parts out of 1,000 towards a perfect vacuum. I mean, let me just put this in terms of a graphical representation. Here I have 255 pixel depth of color. So basically 255 is white and 0 is black. So here is 125. That's going to represent about a 50% vacuum. 20 is going to represent about a 90% vacuum. And 2 is going to represent a 99% vacuum. And the Hyperloop is going to be a 99.9% vacuum, according to the Hyperloop Alpha document.
Thunderfoot's understanding of pressure is so limited, or he's deliberately misinforming people to keep his argument from incredulity going, that he doesn't even understand when pressure differentials should be expressed logarithmically and not linearly as he does here. Stick to chemistry, Thunderfoot. Physics isn't your strong suit. Any physicist will tell you that, for purposes of achieving low pressure via air pumps as the Hyperloop does, these relative pressure comparisons should be logarithmic, not linear. Which means it's actually impossible to get down to zero, a perfect vacuum, and that's fine because a perfect vacuum doesn't actually exist anywhere in the universe, but NASA's Space Power Facility, which Thunderfoot made a big deal of comparing the Hyperloop to, is far, far closer to a vacuum compared to the Hyperloop than the Hyperloop is to 1 atmosphere of pressure, somewhere around 133 micropascals, not even down to the 1 micropascal we just saw him compare it to with the forward compressors. Let's redo Thunderfoot's demonstration on a proper logarithmic scale, which will give us a genuine idea of how difficult it will be for the air pumps to reduce the pressure to the 100 pascals the Hyperloop is designed to run at, compared to this much smaller pressure of 1 micropascal. Since the scale is logarithmic, we can't do zero, so let's have black be this level of 1 micropascal. Which means that, in order to represent 255, or white, as 1 atmosphere, we need a number that, when raised to the power of 255, gives us the number of micropascals in 1 atmosphere. And that's 1.1044. So we raise this number to the power of 0, black, and get 1 micropascal, and we raise it to 255, white, and get 1 atmosphere. Good. Now, on this scale, where is the 100 pascals of pressure, or 10 to the 8 micropascals, the Hyperloop will operate under? Is it here? Is it here? Nope. It's all the way up here. The difference isn't anywhere close to where Thunderfoot made it out to be. So our complaining about Thunderfoot continuously comparing the Hyperloop to a full vacuum isn't being nitpicky. Again, Thunderfoot keeps being off by several orders of magnitude, by a factor of millions if not more, and it matters.
Arguing shades of grey here between left and right is literally hundreds thought was a valid argument to negate my debunking of the Hyperloop is farcical.
Thunderfoot, you made many claims that depended on the Hyperloop being a near vacuum, claims that do not in any way apply with 100 pascals of pressure, claims that are off by several orders of magnitude. You haven't gone back on a single one of those claims. This is not how you answer critics.
Many more, who obviously hadn't actually read the Hyperloop Alfie document like I had.
Oh, so you did read the PDF. Okay, that answers the questions we've been bringing up. You're not ignorant of the Hyperloop proposal. You are lying.
Were also quick to chastise me for not understanding that the giant turbine on the front...
By the way, this isn't a turbine, but a compressor. I didn't bring this up before because it seemed like it was too nitpicky, but now he's kind of pissing me off. A turbine converts compressed or moving air into mechanical energy. A compressor is just the opposite. Energy is used to turn the compressor in order to move air and increase internal pressure. Thunderfoot is being so rude and supercilious to people who know more than he does when he can't even get his terms right.
Was not meant to provide thrust, but to clear away the compressed air in front of the capsule. Why, that's odd, because in the actual Hyperloop Alpha document itself, it makes it bloody clear that yes, the turbine does provide thrust.
Thunderfoot, that's the nozzle expander, not the forward compressor. The nozzle expander is what the Hyperloop uses to stay aloft. Once again, it runs on an air cushion, not magnets as you repeatedly claim. The axial compressor you were spewing misinformation about is over here on the other side of the graphic. From page 17. One important feature of the capsule is the onboard compressor, which serves two purposes. This system allows the capsule to traverse the relatively narrow tube without choking flow that travels between the capsule and the tube walls, resulting in a buildup of air mass in front of the capsule and increasing the drag by compressing air that is bypassed through the capsule. It also supplies air to air bearings that support the weight of the capsule throughout the journey. The rest of the section makes it clear that it is just sending this air onto the intercooler. The axial compressor plays no part in generating the thrust. It doesn't even keep the Hyperloop aloft. That's what the air cushions are for. The nozzle expander Thunderfoot is looking at gets its force only after the incoming air is cooled with water, stored, mixed with steam, and released. Thunderfoot spends the next several minutes talking about the problems of burying the tube, which isn't in the proposal anyway, and goes on a major digression about solar roadways. We'll just skip all of that.
You know, it's a sort of analogous argument to the people saying that, well, they laughed at Copernicus and they laughed at Galileo. Well, yeah, they also laughed at Bozo the Clown, just not for the same reasons.
When I last checked, Bozo the Clown wasn't a dozen engineers working at two of the top technology companies in the world whose findings have been verified by one of the country's top universities, as well as other independent engineering teams. Carl made the argument intending for Bozo the Clown to refer to non-experts just sitting at home making booklets, or nowadays YouTube videos, criticizing scientists and engineers who actually have the requisite knowledge and experience about things that they themselves have no relevant expertise about. Sorry, Thunderfoot, but you're the bozo in this scenario.
Science is not a magical wand that erases all fundamental problems. Like, for instance, building a 600-kilometer-long vacuum tube and firing capsules down it at about the speed of sound.
Well, when last I checked, it wasn't about arguments from incredulity either, but that seems to be the thing you keep relying on. Thunderfoot is behaving precisely the same way as the creationists he used to attack. If something goes against his intuition, he lambasts it without having the relevant expertise, without even trying to understand the actual proposal.
I mean, damn, these tubes need extra structural supports just to hold their own weight, let alone what they would be like under vacuum.
Once again, Thunderfoot shows how much he wants for engineering knowledge. Just because they had supports in that one section at that particular moment, when it isn't given any of the support structures the Hyperloop actually has, does not mean that these same supports are necessary for the Hyperloop. The paper says that stringers are used for support, as well as pillars of reinforced concrete, and so you don't actually need these internal beams once those are in place, for the same reason why you don't need them in an arch or a tunnel. Any way you might deform the tube would require making it longer along one dimension, which these prevent. This third video is by far the lightest as far as actual claims about the Hyperloop go, but not in the area of ridicule, incredulity, ad hominem, and poisoning the well. These are all things that any skeptic would know to take great pains to avoid, but Thunderfoot revels in them, responding to their valid criticism in precisely the same manner as he responded to ours, like when he ridiculed us for the amount of math we used in our first debunking. As someone who used to refute creationists so expertly, he should know that it often takes a lot longer to refute nonsense than it does to spew it. Because then, it's not about incredulity and ridicule, it's about the facts, which can take a while to explain. We, on the other hand, didn't make that many mistakes in our analysis, but what mistakes we did make, we happily corrected. So I'll leave it to you to decide for yourself which of us is employing the techniques that will get us closer to the truth, and which of us is using the same techniques as, say, Kent Hovind.
2 and possibly 3 of the planets are spinning backwards.
So let's compare that to the world's largest vacuum chamber, shall we?
Can you tell me why 8 of the 91 known moons are spinning backwards?
The same mass as the steel in the World Trade Center.
Will you tell me why 4 planets have moons going both directions at the same time?
That's essentially the equivalent of the static capsule being shot with a gun.
By the way, if the Big Bang Theory were true, the matter would be evenly distributed throughout the universe, and it's not.
Because it's got to hold that vacuum almost perfectly whilst it's changing its length.
Was your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandpa a starfish?
Oh, they're just going to repressurize the whole tube. Really, it's just that easy.
What big eyes you have, Grandpa.
It's bringing all of the impracticalities of space travel down to the surface of the Earth.
The new ingredient to turn the frog to a prince is billions and billions of years.
It would quite literally be like being shot down a gun barrel with no way of stopping.
Now, if you find a dinosaur bone, like the one I've got in my museum, a dinosaur toe bone, it does not have a date stamped on it.
And it's complete bullshit.
Thanks for watching, and thanks to Libertarianist for collaborating with me on this and doing a lot of the heavy lifting. Until next time, stay strong and be free.